Hey guys, Mike here, the Detroit Borg, with a look at the 8-inch version of the Galaxy Tab 4 series. So we have the 7-inch, 8-inch, and 10.1-inch, and they're basically the same tablets with the same specs, just with a scaled-up screen. Now this replaces the Tab 3 8-inch, which is now cheaper. This is $269, but you can get it on sale for $239 right now on Amazon. But the original Tab 3 started off at $299. So they gave you some of the price cut while retaining most of the features, but a few things have changed here which may concern people. So let's take a look at our spec sheet. So we have that 8-inch display. Again, same resolution, 1280 by 800. So over 8 inches, that's 189 pixels per inch. Something like the iPad mini without Retina display is at 169 ppi. Now also the iPad mini is priced at $299, so this undercuts it at $269. We have our quad-core processor clocked at 1.2 gigahertz. Now the dual-core from the Tab 3 was clocked at 1.5 gigahertz. This has an IR LED blaster for controlling AV equipment. Now the big step back here for a lot of people and the big concern here is the 3 megapixel fixed focus camera. Now the Tab 3 from last year had a 5 megapixel autofocusing camera. Now both cameras do 720p HD video, so not a huge difference in output. Now we're running the latest version of Android 4.4.2 with an updated version of TouchWiz, which kind of takes after the Tab Pro series. Now once again, we're looking at the Wi-Fi only version, but you can get a 3G or LTE version, which includes GSM voice and text messaging. So if you want that in your tablet, you certainly could get that. And of course, this is available in white or black, and I went with the white version. So let's go ahead, crack the seal, and take a look. Just pop the top. Slide it out, and there it is. Galaxy Tab 4, owning a Galaxy has its rewards. 8-inch WXGA display. We have multi-window mode and multi-user mode, and it's really dusty with that recyclable packaging. It seems to be a problem with all Samsung packaging. But let's go ahead and lift this out of its tray. And as you can see, it's got a piece of plastic kind of stuck to the back of it, so let's just go ahead and peel that off. All right, so let's just lift off the front cover, protecting the display. And there we go. You can see it's pretty much a blown up version of the 7-inch I previously reviewed, but it's a little wider. As you can see, we got a center mounted camera. And if I look closely here, I see there's a little piece of plastic covering that camera. So let me go ahead and peel that off. All right, so let's take a quick look at the accessories, which I know you guys are all familiar with, but we have a black USB charging cable, which I was expecting white to match the tablet. You do get a white one with a 7-inch, so I'm not sure if this is a mistake or the way it is with the 8-inch tablets, but there you go, black micro USB charging cable. We also have a black wall adapter, Samsung branded. And then we have a packet full of some paperwork. So we have our quick start guide, pretty familiar stuff. We have Only the Galaxy has its rewards, just an incentive to register your Galaxy product, software upgrade instructions, which are pretty basic, and then we have our safety and warranty guide information in multiple languages. All right, so let's go ahead and boot this up for the first time. Just going to tap and hold the power button just above the volume rocker. Now, the design is pretty familiar. It's a little more angular than it was last year. The Tab 3 was a little more rounded, but it pretty much has the same overall footprint. Now the speaker is pretty decent, even though it's laying flat on the table right now. Alright, so let's take a look at the design and features. And the great thing about the 8-inch model is that it's nice and compact, as is the 7-inch model. But as you can see here, it's quite a bit larger, which gives you a lot more screen real estate. But otherwise, they're pretty much the same device, it's just blown up in size. So maybe some people like the more compact design of the 7-inch model versus the 8-inch model. But otherwise, they're very similar, same specs and that sort of thing. Now, the 7-inch model is a little thicker than the 8-inch model, so that means the 8-inch model's camera sort of sticks out a bit more on the back. Now, toward the bottom, you have our new Android keys. And if you look down here, you can see they are not backlit. You have your recent apps button, which used to be a menu button, but you can tap and hold on this to get to the menu function. You also have your home button and back button. If you double tap the home button, it takes you to S Voice. If you tap and hold the home button, it takes you to Google Now. So you have two voice assistants to access right from the home button. Up top, you have a 1.3 megapixel VGA camera. There is no ambient light sensor for adapting the screen, and there's no LED notification light, so it's pretty basic. Now along the back, we have this sort of faux leather texture without the stitching like you get with the Tab Pro series. So it's a little more simple, more of a unibody construction. As you can see, it wraps around the edge. It gives you more of a solid feel to it, but doesn't feel as premium as the Tab Pros, for example. You can see we have our single mono speaker with a little bump out here to prevent you from muffling the speaker when you lay it flat on the table. But again, there are no stereo speakers like they were last year, which used to be at the edge here. So we have our USB 2.0 port. This is a micro USB 2.0 port. On the back, we have that camera. This is a, again, 3.5 megapixel fixed focus camera, so no autofocus in here, and there, of course, is no LED light for flashing the scene. You have to get the pros for that. Now, if you look back here again, you can see the camera module sticks out a little bit more than it does on the 7-inch model, but if you look along the side here, we have our single microphone, not a particularly good one. We have our sleep-wake button, a volume rocker. We also have our LED, or IR LED blaster for controlling AV equipment, which again works with the included watch on app. Now on the back, you can also see our capacity. That's 16 gigs, while the 7-inch comes standard with 8 gigs. But there is this micro SD card slot, which allows you to expand storage up to 64 gigs beyond what's included. Now at the top, we have this little bump out here for our headphone jack. Now to just briefly compare this to the Tab Pro 8.4-inch, again, this is a much higher-end tablet. It clocks in at $400 versus $269 for the Tab Pro or the Tab 4 8.0. So this is a higher-end tablet, has a much higher resolution display. In fact, the pixel density is 359, again, versus 189 over here. We have an ambient light sensor. We have a higher-quality camera on the front. We have backlit Android controls right here. We have higher-end processing power. We also have an 8-megapixel autofocusing camera with an LED flash. We also have stereo speakers at the edge of the device versus one firing at the back. Now, this tablet can be used in portrait or landscape orientation. In fact, the IR Blaster is in landscape orientation, so if you want to use it as a remote control, this is the orientation you're going to use. So let's go ahead and unlock this device and take a look around the software. Alright, so let's take a look at our user interface, which is pretty familiar. Again, this looks a lot like the Tab Pro series, but you can see we do not have the My Magazine feature, which is unique to the Tab Pro, the Notes, as well as the Galaxy S5. So higher end tablets with more processing power and RAM have those sort of features. You can pinch in and out to see all of your home screens. You can select which one you want to be your home screen. You can also add new home screens, rearrange them, and then if you don't want it, just drag it up here to remove it. Now, you can also tap anywhere on this little bar down here to select which home screen you want to view, and you can go to your app drawer and add more apps to your home screen. Now, the app drawer has also been enhanced here, so you can add foldering, for example. So we can create a folder here, and we're just going to do test. So this allows us to organize all of the apps in our app drawer. As you can see here, it's created a new page just for foldering. Now, if you want to organize the apps in the app drawer, what you have to do is go up to Edit, and then this allows us to edit it. So in fact, if we go to our folder, we can now just add items from our folder. So for example, I can add Instagram and Twitter. Click done. Now once I'm done editing, I can click save and I can drag this folder to one of the home screens. In fact, I get this little editor down here, which allows me to see the home screens I want to drop it into before I do so. There you go. Now when you're on the home screen, if you tap and hold one of these items, you can see we get to app information. You can remove the app or create a folder. So if you want to go up to app info, it just gives you all the information. This is also available under settings, but this is a great way of quickly accessing app data. Now, if you look down here, you can see we have our Google widget, which is always there no matter what home screen you're looking at. But what you can't do here like you can with the GS5 is say, okay, Google, to start a search. So you do have to tap on it. Now let's take a quick look at the app drawer and the apps they've included. Now, as you can see here, you can no longer pinch in and out to see all of the pages of apps or widgets, but you can use this little slider here to slide between all those pages. You can also see all your downloaded apps. Twitter, Instagram were ones I downloaded. Kids Mode is an app that comes with a tablet but doesn't come pre-installed. So you see the icon, when you tap on it, it downloads it for you. Now, Kids Mode I've explored in the GS5 video. Basically, it's a sandboxed environment that allows kids to interact with your device without affecting the device, so they can't accidentally delete things or have access to things you don't want them to. And the only way to get out of it is if they know the PIN which you input. So anyway, taking a look at the apps, you can see we have the standard array of Samsung apps, which includes My Files, which is a very nice file manager, which Android normally doesn't include. So you can see all your images, your videos, your music, documents, downloaded apps, your download history. You can also see all your office apps, and you can see your cloud accounts, such as Dropbox. So right now, it's just populating that. We also have the internet browser, the calendar, which is now a much better looking app than it was before. Very simple and clean. Again, it looks like the updated version of TouchWiz on the other Galaxy devices from 2014. We have a memo app, which is also very nice. We're going to use that to demonstrate the keyboard. We also have our onboard music and video player with our camera app and gallery app. Now, there's the standard Samsung gallery app, but there's also the Photos app from Google. So as you can see here, we have the Samsung apps, then we have the Google apps, and then we have some third-party apps. Now, interestingly, they've preloaded Netflix. Now, Netflix does not come on the 7-inch model, probably because there isn't a lot of onboard storage there. We also have the Handcom Office Viewer, which is included in all the Tab 4 products. It's just a viewer. It's not an editor, so you can open up Excel, Word, and PowerPoint documents. Now, this also did not come pre-installed. You get the icon, and you have to download it when you activate it. You also have have Dropbox, and you get 50 gigs of free storage when you sign up with Dropbox on this device for the first time. Now, we also have the Watch On app, and this is an app that you can set up pretty easily. All you have to do is input your current location and select your service provider. So, for example, I'm Comcast. I'm going to select that. Click Next. And now it's populating what's on TV right now. So you can see all the channels or all the programming that's available right now. And you also have On Demand, so you can access things through other services like Netflix or Hulu or Vudu or whatever services you can download separately. You can also add your remote control here. So let's go ahead and set that up. Basically, you just select your brand of television set or your set-top box or your AV equipment. Click Next. And it will kind of coach you through the process of determining what code works with your TV. And once you're done, you can click OK. So now I have my remote control right on screen right here. Or I can select one of these programs. So let's see. Let's just go ahead and pick that program. Click Watch on TV. It's sending the code to the TV to change it to that channel. And you can start watching it all without having to go to the on-screen menu on your TV to find out what show you want to watch. Now, if we go up to settings, the app drawer actually allows us to uninstall or disable apps. So if we go to uninstall/disable apps, you can see the apps that are eligible for that. So not all apps can be disabled or uninstalled. Most apps here cannot be uninstalled. In fact, even Netflix can't be uninstalled. So for example, if I go here and select Netflix, you can see I can disable the app, I can't uninstall it. But if I go to the apps I downloaded, such as Twitter and Instagram, I can uninstall those. So I'm going to click a cancel right there. Now, if you disable an app such as the Handcom Viewer, click OK. So it disappears from the app drawer, but if you want to see it again, just go Show Disabled Apps. And if you want to re-enable it, just check it, click Done, and it goes back to the app drawer. Now, we also have our drop-down shade. As you can see here, we have these quick setting toggles, which are very useful. This is one of the great things about TouchWiz, is that you can quickly access very often used features such as Wi-Fi, your location, your sound controls. You can tap on it like so to modify your sound, power saving mode, airplane mode, etc. And if you want to get to these control panels, just tap and hold on them. It takes you right to the settings panel where you can adjust them more precisely or adjust more settings precisely. So for example, you do have to enable this feature in order to edit it. Now I can adjust whether I want the CPU performance to be dialed down or the screen output to be dialed down manually right here. So again, you have lots of options. Now we also have blocking mode, which is very useful. It's basically a do not disturb feature. So again, if we tap and hold on that, you can see here we can turn it on like so, and then we can edit this. So we can turn off notifications and turn off alarms, or select one or the other. You can also select specific times of day. So if you want this to go off when you're sleeping at night, you can do so just by adjusting the time. Now, in terms of features, there's not a lot going on here. We have Smart Stay, which is probably the one standout feature that Samsung likes to add to its tablets. We're pretty familiar with this at this point. Basically, the camera is watching for the presence of your eyes. So if you have this enabled, it will prevent the screen from going to sleep if you're looking at the tablet, or allow it to go to sleep if you're not looking at the tablet. And of course, if it doesn't see your eyes, it will tell you in the notification bar up top. Now, screen mirroring is pretty basic. If you have an all-share cast equipped device like a Samsung Smart TV, you can broadcast your tablet's display wirelessly, including audio, to that television set. Now, we also have our recent apps, and as you can see here, they're all suspended. You can swipe them out of the way to close them, or you can launch them like so. As you can see, it actually responds pretty quickly. You can close all of the apps, or you can go to Task Manager. And this will bring you to your Task Manager under Settings, so you can end all of your apps. You can go to your downloaded apps. You can see your RAM manager, see how much RAM you're using up right now. And you can see your storage. So you can see I have quite a bit of storage left. Again, I had 16 gigs to start with, but I haven't really downloaded many apps yet or taken many photos. Now, we also have this multi-window mode, which you can activate by swiping in from the right-hand edge, either in portrait or landscape orientation. You can also swipe it out of the way. Alternatively, you can also tap and hold the back button to activate that drawer. Now, as you can see here, we have quite a few apps in here, but not all of them. If you go up to this editor, you can add even more apps. You can add as many as you can fit in here. So for example, I can continue dropping them like so. So basically, this allows me to open up two windows at once. So I can drag and drop one app, then I can drag and drop another app. So now I can watch video on one side of the tablet while exploring the web on the other side. And as you can see here, I can also resize the window. And when I'm interacting with one of the windows, you can see it outlines in blue. So when I tap this center button, I can now switch between one side to the other side. I can copy text or items from one window to the other side of the window. Or I can close one of these windows, the one that's active, or I can resize it to full screen. All right, so let's take a look at our settings panel. Now, the settings panel is divided into these tabs, connections, devices, controls, and general. You can see we have Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, airplane mode, data usage, location information, so you can see what apps are using your location. More networks, so you can set up your VPN. You also have printing here because this does integrate printing services thanks to Android 4.4.2. And under device, we have our sound options. So for example, you can disable those touch sounds, which a lot of people do not like. You also have lock screen. So you have your lock screen settings, and one of them is shortcuts. So you can add shortcuts to the lock screen. And if you tap on that, you can actually edit what appears under shortcuts. So for example, if I want Chrome, I can do so, or I can remove one of these apps just by tapping and holding on it and taking it down to delete. So now if I go to my lock screen, you'll see I have those shortcuts right on the lock screen. I can swipe up to launch right into that app. Now we also have our fonts, so you can see the font styles that are available here. So yep, there you go. You can also download additional fonts. I believe this is coming from the Samsung App Store. Yes, so you can add additional fonts if you want. You also have your notification panel. Under notification panel, you can disable the brightness and volume slider. So if you go to that notification panel, you can see those are right here, which are very handy. And if you want additional volume controls, you just tap the gear icon here. So you can see you can control volumes for notifications, media, and system independently. Now we also have this toggle for recommended apps. And basically what happens when you have this turned on is if you connect a set of headphones, you go to the notification panel now, it detects that you've connected headphones and may want to launch one of these apps that can use them. But you can also go up to edit to change exactly what apps appear here. So for example, if you want some apps to appear here, but not others, for example, if you don't want the browser to appear here, you can disable that. But if you want Netflix to appear, you can do that as well. All you have to do is click done, and when you go to the drop-down shade now, you can see that's been updated to include Netflix. Now under controls, we have our language and input methods. So for example, if you download third-party keyboard apps like the Google keyboard, you can select which one you want to be defaulted to. We also have our palm motion, and there's not a lot here. We have screen capture and mute pause. Now screen capture is pretty basic, so let me just get to the screen, the home screen. All I have to do is swipe the edge of your palm against the screen and it does a screen grab. Not necessarily the best place to do because as you can see, it swiped between the different home screens. But again, swipe. There we go. If you go to the drop-down notification shade, you'll see it right there and you can launch it or share it or delete it, that sort of thing. Now, instead of digging through all these menus, you could just go up to search right up here and search for your item. So for example, if you want to change your wallpaper, it brings up wallpaper. Now, in terms of wallpaper, there is one feature here that's available on the lock screen only, which is travel wallpapers. This works with TripAdvisor. Basically, what will happen here is that it will refresh the lock screen wallpaper to a travel destination every 3 hours or greater. Let's click cancel. So now if we go to the lock screen, you'll see we have this travel destination and city name, so Quebec City, Canada. Now you can add additional users just by going to settings, going to general, and going to users. So here you can add additional users, two different types of users. You can do the standard user, which will allow the person to log in with their Google account, their Samsung account, their Dropbox account, and basically have their own tablet experience independent of the primary owner. So let's go and set that up right now to show you how this works. So as you can see here on the lock screen, we have two users now. You have me, which is the primary user, and then the new user. So if I select the new user, swipe up to unlock it, I can now set it up for that user. So I've logged in with a completely different Google account. This means I have my own tablet experience independent of the primary user. So this means I have access to my Gmail, not their Gmail. I have access to my Play Store, not their Play Store. So it's completely separated. This means I can modify it any way I want. I can download my own apps. I can take my own photos and videos. I can set my own wallpaper, that sort of thing. Now if I jump back to the lock screen, you can see I'm currently active in the secondary guest account, but if I want to re-log into my main account, I just have to tap that icon. As you can see, it changes the wallpaper and even my shortcuts on the lock screen. I can swipe to unlock it. Now, if I want to remove that user, just tap on it, click trash, and click delete. Now, there's another type of user here called restricted profile. So what will happen here is that you can create another profile just for limited access. So you do have to set up a security PIN for this. So this allows me to have very specific controls. I can dictate what apps they have access to. So for example, if I just want them to have access to the calculator. Now certain apps have additional settings here, such as play movies and TV. And I can go to settings here and I can restrict what type of content is allowed in that app. So this is great, for example, if you want to set this mode up for your children. So if I go to the lock screen now, I can select the restricted profile. So as you can see here, in this profile, you have very limited access. In fact, if you go to the Play Store, if I have an authorized access to it, it will tell that user that they don't have access. But you can see the apps I selected, and some of the main apps, such as the camera app, are all in here. Now, if you want to get back to the main user, as you can see now, it's behind a security code.
So that prevents the restricted user from accessing the main account.
Now let's take a look at our keyboard. So as you can see, we have a full QWERTY keyboard with our number row up top. We have our directional keys right here, which is very nice to have. We also have our settings here. So if we can tap and hold on that, we get to our quick settings, which includes our keyboard options, which in the case of the 8-inch, but not 7-inch model, includes a split keyboard for thumb typing. We also have our floating keyboard and the full normal QWERTY keyboard. So there we go. We have our split keyboard, which you can move around, and it works in landscape or portrait orientation. So even more thumbable keyboard. But I think in the case of the 8-inch tab, at least for my big hands, I think this keyboard is a little too small. Now we also have handwriting recognition. So you can use a stylus or just use your finger. So once again, all you have to do is type in the word and hopefully get it right. Hello. So it recognizes letters and punctuation and did a pretty good job despite my terrible penmanship. Now we also have a swipe-like keyboard, which we have to enable under settings. I've already enabled here, continuous input, that's what you're looking for. And now if you bring up the keyboard here, you can see it works pretty well. All right, so let's quickly take a look at the camera app, which is pretty basic. Now, as you can see here, you can go up to settings to change your resolution. So for example, I have my photo size here. I want 16 by 9 to fill up the screen. There we go. Now, when you're in this mode, you can shoot a photograph. Now, what you can't do here is tap to focus. So there is no auto-focusing in here. You can pinch in and out to zoom. Of course, it's just digital cropping. But there is no exposure compensation with tap. It's all automatic. We also have our filters down here. So as you can see, grayscale, sepia, negative, and that sort of thing. So we're going to go with no effect. Now you can also switch between the front-facing and rear-facing camera as so. And just to show you just how low resolution this camera is, we have our photo size here, which is 4x3. So this is 1.3 megapixels. Now the 7-inch only gives you 0.3 megapixels, which is VGA. So this isn't quite VGA actually, but it is VGA video. So if you go to video mode, in fact, I have to be in video mode before I can mess with those settings. So let's go here to settings. You can see again, 640 by 480 VGA 4x3. Now let's take a look at video mode. So you still have those filters as well. You have your settings right here. You can change your video size. Go to more settings for brightness controls, guidelines, timer, white balance, volume key, review location, etc. You can record video. You can pause it or you can stop it, but you cannot shoot photos at the same time. Again, you can't pinch in and out to zoom or that sort of thing. And of course, there is no autofocusing. Now, just to take a quick look at our Geekbench scores, you can see the Tab Pro definitely outperforms the Tab 4 considerably here. This is running a 2.25 gigahertz quad-core processor with 2 gigs of RAM. Again, this is on 1.2 gigahertz quad-core processor with 1.5 gigs of RAM. Now, this is nearly identical to the 7-inch model here. As you can see, they are running the same spec, so it makes sense. Now this is actually substantially better than the iPad mini without Retina display, as you can see here. All right, so let's talk about some of the strengths and weaknesses of the Tab 4 8.0. Now in terms of the strengths, I think it boils down to three things: the price, the size, and the software. So in terms of price, I'm actually pretty impressed here. At $269 or $239 while it's on sale, that's a great bargain for this tablet. So other tablets like the 7-inch Tab 4 is $199. That's not on sale right now. So for only $40 more, you get a larger tablet with 16 gigs of storage instead of 8 gigs of storage. And I think the 8-inch form factor is the perfect size. Now you also get the latest version of Android, Android 4.4.2, which is fantastic. You also get an updated version of TouchWiz, which seems to work pretty well on this tablet. It actually seems to work better than the 7-inch tablet. I'm not sure why that is, but overall system performance with the 8-inch tablet is much better than the 7-inch. Now a lot of people don't like TouchWiz, but I think in this case they've done a nice job kind of slimming it down and giving us only the features that really matter. Now in terms of weaknesses, I think it really boils down to the cameras, the speaker, and the display. Now I don't think the display is too bad, but it's kind of on the dim side. But more importantly, the pixel density really isn't that great. 189 pixels per inch isn't fantastic. It is better than the iPad mini without Retina display. But if you intend to use this as an e-reader, some people may find the graininess of the text to be a little too fatiguing on the eyes. The other problem here are the cameras, which are pretty mediocre and worse than last year. But I'm not sure how important it is to most people. I don't think tablet cameras are that important for a lot of people. I think it's used mostly as a utility for certain apps that need to use the camera. But I think for most people, they're going to use the cameras on their smartphone, which are always going to be better. Now, I think for me, the biggest weakness may be the speaker. It's a single mono speaker, which seems to be pretty loud. It's not a terrible speaker, but it definitely isn't as good as the stereo speakers on a lot of tablets now. Alrighty guys, so that's going to do for me with the 8-inch Tab 4. What I want to know from you guys is, which size do you think is perfect for you, 7, 8, or 10-inch? So let me know in the comment section below, and until then, see you in my next video.